I am delighted to introduce to you Jens Hoffmann, our Susanne Feld Hilberry, Senior Curator at Large. Jens, you're on. Come on up.
Thank you very much, Amy. Good morning, everyone. I just want to actually follow up on Amy's call for membership. If you're not a member, please get a membership. Tell your friends how wonderful and amazing MOCAD is. We need all of your support and all the support of your friends. And membership is cheap. It gives you a lot of benefits, including talks like this in the early hours of a Saturday morning. I'm very, very happy to have next to me Nancy Mitchnick. An outstanding artist, as you all know, here from Detroit. And for me, Nancy is pretty much one of the people here in Detroit that perhaps exemplifies also the program that we're trying to do here at the museum. When I started here about 3 years ago, and Alicia Bauer-Rieder came on board as a director, one of the things that we wanted to do was very much connect Detroit with a national and also an international discussion. And while Nancy is, of course, very rooted here in Detroit, she's also traveled from coast to coast. She's been teacher in some of the most prestigious art schools in the world, at CalArts in Los Angeles, as well as at Harvard University, and really sort of crisscrossed the country, made many friends, and influenced a whole generation of incredible students. And I hope we're going to talk a little bit about this. The whole period of the Cass Corridor, of course, is an artistic legacy here in Detroit, an unbelievable artistic history here in Detroit that is, till this day, still not fully understood and discovered. And I think MOCAD is really on the way of looking into this more seriously, and I'm really happy that the beginning of our investigations into that history and legacy is being done here with Nancy. So welcome, and also happy birthday. You served finally 40.
I'm getting old.
So there's so many things that Amy mentioned in her introduction that I'm also curious about. The idea of failure was something that we talked about a lot when we came to your studio, and I'm always of the opinion there isn't really any such thing as failure. It's just sort of like look at things and move forward and learn. And tell me, how did you... What was your experience working on this exhibition, having this enormous body of work that you've made, and also sort of like coming back here to Detroit after living away for a long time?
Boy, that's a question. It's been absolutely fabulous working on the show. What I like to do is paint. And it came up a little quick. I had the option of having this show in 2017, but I was really ready to get productive now. I have a small studio in the Russell Industrial Complex, which is a little bit of a creepy place, as many of you know. But once I knew that this was happening and this gallery is so large, I had to rent another studio. Thanks to the Kresge grant, actually, I was able to do that, 3,500 square feet. So I could make, I'm actually slow. The paintings look fast, I hope they look easy, but they come along very slowly. It's oil paint, they need to dry between hits. So I was working on 5-6 paintings at the same time, two of which are in New York at the Academy of Arts and Letters, which I'm kind of pleased with, although I'm sorry they're not here. So it was incredible to do the work. What I like to do is work. And I got into this funny schedule of starting around 2 and going to sleep around 5. I kind of lived in my studio. So that was the most fun. The funny thing about the failure exhibition is I had a painting that was shown at the Scarab Club. I decided to change it because I felt there was an absence of courage. I'm going to give a whole talk about this. And Jens did me this incredible favor. It's hanging in the hallway in front of my small studio at the Russell. It's actually destroyed. It's a hideous painting. I wrecked it. I have a great set of images that prove that I wrecked it, that I want to talk about. And then Jens turns up, and he looks at it. He picks it up from the wall and says, oh, I'd love this to be in the show. And I said, you can't have it in the show. It's the subject of my failure painting. I don't want it in the show. It's a horrible painting. He said, no, I really like it. It's very contemporary. Let's put it in the show. And I said, could we put it outside of the show? He said, okay. I knew he was fibbing. And I took the painting. I mean, we took it down. It was a little cracked. It was rumbled around. It'd been in the big show. I'd sort of messed around with it. And I really could not have this painting hung in a show at MOCAD. So we got it restretched, and I repainted the whole thing. And instead of being a bitchy painting about my relationship with my mother, it became a kind of graceful, emotional, forgive me painting about me and my mother. I'm only almost 70, and I finally forgave her. So he did me this amazing favor by screwing up with my failure talk, and I am truly forever grateful. The painting isn't so bad now, I hope you think it's all right.
I still like it a lot, and it's one of my favorite in the exhibitions, but what I really liked about it was that it sort of showed another way of the way you work, and you know, we have only known each other for a couple of years, but you have a quite exuberant nature, a sort of very outgoing personality, and I felt like this has to be also in the show. Like some of the other works that you see of the abandoned houses, they're extremely formal and kind of like have this rigid base to them. And it's like, I know why Nancy is doing this. This is like very clear. This is very sort of straightforward. This is very controlled. But, you know, she needs to let her off the leash a little bit. And that's, I think, what this other painting really like represented to me. Like very wild in its composition, lots of colors, very gestural. You know, I was thinking, in contrast to the works that we hung on the other side of the gallery, the pink garage doors, you know, which are so sort of straight and formal and rigid. And I think they make a nice dialogue.
Well, you know, there's a whole body of work that's going to happen about my family, which was my original idea about doing the Detroit paintings. And I ditched the idea once, you know, I'm not a mother with a bundt pan painter, but I really wanted to do something that had to do with my own identity and growing up in Detroit. And I worked for a couple of years before I figured out to paint the house paintings, the Detroit Project, I call it. But I'm going to make a body of work with, well, my family and people who I love with that same set of heads on caryatids that comes from a painting in Pompeii. And this copy of a Greek relief, and have, my dad liked to fly model airplanes, and when I do my dad, there'll be model airplanes, and my brother will have hang gliders, and I'll start having a little more fun. But the truth, and I will reveal it, is, and many of you know, my life has been difficult and chaotic, and I've been very chaotic in my own experience of reality, which I've never quite understood. It's my least favorite notion. So the organization of the paintings was something I desperately needed, so I had some control over something, and the studio was sort of my sacred territory. And the fact that my mind could get organized enough to make a very structured, I hope not rigid really, painting was my way to prove I did exist in reality, I guess that might be the low hold card. And now, you know, being back in Detroit, the first 2 years were an absolute nightmare, which I won't go over. Very rough, cars being destroyed on the street when I'm reading The New Yorker. I lived in a street that a lot of drunks, two cars, I wasn't even in them. You know, house break-ins, my beloved, you know, bad things. It was a bad 2 years. My closest friend here being diagnosed with brain cancer, you know, Suzanne and I go back since we were in our 20s. It was really hard. And as it began to become more clear and I became more supported and I sort of recovered my natural existence without being a Harvard professor, which sort of gave me an identity that was great cover for a lot of years. And also kind of fun because I could mess around with those rigid Yankee guys.
In the beginning of my introduction, I mentioned that you moved out to Southern California, to LA, and you taught at Kellard's.
Now that was difficult also. But I know I'm a yammerer, but the thing is that now that I'm actually calm, more settled, more serene, I mean, I'm almost 70, so it had to happen at some point. And also the chance of doing this large body of work and the money, really, to make large stretchers, have a great studio assistant, and do the work I really have been wanting to do for quite a few years in a big studio, which I like to enjoy, gave me the opportunity to start messing up in the paintings. And this has really been fun, and I don't know that I've gotten around to it yet if I hadn't had this show. So the Indian princess, you know, in an Indian miniature is about 2 inches. I'm a heroic scale girl. And potatoes coming down from the sky and putting an Arctic owl and a tortoise. I think I showed the picture to Lorraine over the phone and she said, since when is there a tortoise intersection in Hamtramck? So I'm really beginning to have fun, and thank you for this chance to get through my uptightness, and there's gonna be a whole new body of work that's, I don't know, I wouldn't call it magic realism, but it's really going to be interesting to make. The hidden agenda, I suppose, is global warming, but don't tell anybody I have a political, you know, nerve anywhere.
So you came from Detroit, you were part of the cast corridor, scene.
Another that was truly
very
great.
Dominated by male artists, focusing mostly on abstraction. You're going to LA to Cal Arts, another school very much dominated by white male artists. Not
wrong.
Abstraction, but
Cal
conceptual.
Arts was dominated by, when I was there, gay feminist wild women. It was fabulous, and it was all about the gays. And I was, you know, the figure painter. I was the painting teacher in an environment where painting was supposed to be dead. I didn't know for years that it was actually the great conceptual artist, Michael Asher, that figured, kids want to learn to paint, let's give them some money who won't cave.
So Michael Asher was straight and conceptual, and John Baldessari was straight and conceptual.
Yeah.
Who were the gays?
The dean, when I was there, was the hottest woman on earth. I don't know if she's here. Catherine Lord, her girlfriend was Millie Wilson. It was an insanely fabulous. It was the only faculty I've ever taught in where they actually respected and were interested in difference. It wasn't just hearsay. You know, I was paranoid when I was there. You know, I'm an intuitive romantic painter. And Catherine just calmed me down one day. So you have a place at the table, shut up. And these faculty meetings, we all agreed to have total consent. They lasted 8 hours sometimes. But I mean, it was just an amazing environment, and it took me a couple of years to calm down. I used to go cry in the bathroom when a student frightened me. Years later, I could just go, fuck you and the boat you came in on. It is intuitive. But that took a while before I toughened up. And I learned a lot there. I learned if they wanted
portraits. Was there anything
portraits.
That influenced you when you were there?
Something I taught decapitation. They wanted still lives. I taught an erotic still life class. I got hipper. It was really interesting. It was the best of my learning experiences, actually. It came by hard. And I figured eventually that I actually am pretty smart, because sometimes I won an argument with all these absolutely brilliant people. It was a very wonderful time. And the last place I ever wanted to spend time in was New England.
That's where you went afterwards.
Yeah, I was seduced.
Why did you leave LA?
I didn't want to.
No, but why did you?
Well, they offered me a job, and they offered me, I had a boyfriend who had a small plane. We flew around. I lived in a compound. I had a studio that was 6,000 square feet for $800 a month. It was in the high mountains. I had a beautiful dog and a cat and a raven. She had a broken wing, but we set her up in a tree outside and her friends visited. It was just sublime. It was an amazing studio. I painted the table paintings there. I painted Wonder Woman there. And I began to love Cal Arts, although it was a hardcore job. You're working till 11 at night. At Cal Arts, the philosophy was, if you didn't have 80 students, you weren't doing your job. Everybody worked hard to show they could work harder. Basically, it was a nightmare, but ask Lorraine. When I was interviewed at Harvard, they offered me my CalArts salary. And I said, thanks, guys, out of here. I wouldn't cross the street for $40,000 a year. So I was free to go back home where I wanted to be. And then they kept calling me, what about 50? What about 60? What about 70? And my shrink said, it'll look good in your resume, just go for a year. And 15 years later, a conceptual artist cut me off. But
I always
it was a great 15 years.
I always love talking about your biography. But let's talk a little bit more about the work.
Okay, the work. I've spent my life doing it.
Exactly. And I think this is also the audience, just to sort of like give an introduction to what we are seeing and how this grew out of the, you know, the work that you did in the 70s and then in LA and then, you know, coming back here.
You know, my paintings in Detroit when I started, I didn't have a plan. I wasn't a classical artist with ideas that I executed. And I was extremely insecure about painting portraits and still lives and eventually landscapes. But once I was taken with something and I actually knew it, it was more about sensation, experience, desire, and kind of emotion. And it did embarrass me always, because I wanted to be an abstract painter. Egner wanted me to work like Frank Stella. That was never gonna happen. But once I got going with something, and usually it would last about 2 years, I was so in the throes of it, I didn't worry about the absence of conception. I just worried about the work, and I gave it everything I had. So there's some great paintings of Greggy Murphy and Michael Lukes and all the artists at the time. And when we had the Kick Out the Jam show, you know, they showed them outside the gallery. But I'm very proud of those paintings. And at different times, so that's what I did in Detroit. I painted my friends. And I knew nothing about Alex Katz, and I had no idea that I was a heroic scale painter. And the only interpretive, descriptive, analytical thought I had was that there was psychological content. I went for an interview once and asked Ellen Phelan, give me a phrase. She said, use psychological content. And I've been using it for the last 50 years. I've become articulate somewhat from teaching. I learned a lot about talking about paintings from teaching. And after Detroit, I moved to New York. Actually, the Cass Corridor was an incredibly great experience, and Ellen Phelan and I weren't really conscious that we weren't invited to parties and nobody cared that much about us, and we kind of had to beg to have shows. We were really a part of it, and by Kurt Gallery, Klaus Curtis, after a show called 12 Statements of, I'm going biographical again. Anyway, Klaus said to me, when I was still in Detroit, you know, I think you and Ellen are the most interesting artists here. And I practically flipped out. I said, you do? He said, yeah, I really do. And I had my show. I decided to move to New York with my daughter. The show, for lots of reasons, the show sold out and I could do it. Of course, then I got arrested for $5,000 worth of parking tickets and had to paint portraits all summer, but that's another story. So those were the portraits. And I trusted myself making them. I got to New York. The work was very weak for quite a few years. I worked for Bryce Martin. I started painting screens and dealing with planar structure. I loved the fact that painting was a mystery. For me, it was my experience of the reality I could conjure up happened when I was actually painting. And I remember Roberta Smith coming to the studio once, and these screens were big paintings. And she said, oh, I get it. All your different ways of your personalities, you're behind the screens. And I was so upset that was true. And once I knew why I was doing them, I couldn't do them anymore. It was like a quest. My paintings were a quest. And the funny thing about them is they're really visual. They're in a visual language. I have both sides. I'm very well read. Obviously, I can, you know, I could talk for the next 20 hours. But the work is silent to me. It's silent. I think it's hard to write about. It's very hard for me to talk about. I can tell stories about how I got there. I can talk about the process. And I now finally trust myself and can tolerate the fact that I'm not a conceptual artist. But
you said two things that I maybe wanted to explore further. One was related to this. Sorry?
Your turn.
I just want to ask you this. Two things that you said. I'm sort of was interested in the idea of painting and as mystery, or the mystery of painting, and what you mean by that. And there was another thing that you said, that I wasn't interested in the conception of a painting. I was just interested in the work itself. What does it mean to be interested in the work itself?
Well, my work is always finding out about what I'm doing. So Bob Wilbert was a good teacher, and I'm very comfortable working with paint. And it is really, it's grungy work.
So it's sort of like a process of like learning by doing, and exploring.
Yeah, so setting up the palette and finding it out. So I'll paint something, repaint it. I mean, the failure painting must have 10 paintings that I've documented underneath it. And for a peculiar reason, I didn't know when to stop. And I've ruined a lot of paintings, John Corbin can tell you, because they came too easy sometimes, and I didn't think 5 hours was enough, and I would totally wreck them. I had a very hard time controlling and really understanding what I did. Sometimes a friend of mine would stop me, and sometimes I just knew enough. I think it took me 2 decades to even get close to knowing just when to cut it out already. And, you know, if you paint and you don't have enough money to work as large as you want to, I don't know, my early paintings probably have 15 paintings under them. But to find out what I was doing, I would paint to find it. And if I was lucky, I'd stop in time. And the process of making the painting and figuring out while you're doing it is still just, I'm still madly fascinated by it. That big painting called Big Burn was never really finished. Now I trust myself a little more. I'd say 90% of the time, when I make a mark, my criteria is more clear about how I want it to look and how I feel about it. If I can't put another mark down that's a genuine response to something, sometimes it's something I'm seeing, sometimes it's something I'm feeling, I stop. I'll tell you, smoking cigarettes made it a lot easier. 20 minutes you had to smoke, you looked at your painting. I teach my students, look at the painting. Now if I work on a few things at the same time and I let them dry, like I wrecked the turtle and the owl the other day. They were kind enough to let me work here. I thought a couple hours turned into 7. And my studio assistant, who's a classical painter who renders, you know, he draws first, organizes the painting, and then brings the painting up. And obviously many great artists work that way. But us wet-on-wet painters just flail around a little bit. He said, don't touch it, don't touch it. Let it dry. He was getting brave enough to sort of tell me what to do. I took care of that, actually.
Do you think it's harder to start a painting or to finish it?
It's way harder to finish it. The fun is the start. I could wipe it off. I wiped it off. The ground was dry. I wiped that whole turtle off and found the original turtle and got it better. Sometimes accuracy doesn't help. If you're an image maker and your criteria is only accuracy, you can really make a lot of dead work if getting it exactly right is the only plan you have. What's right for me is some inevitable quality about the color, the structure, the way it's organized, the way it fills the space. I work very, very hard. I suppose in that way I am abstract, to get the image of what I know I want to make. And now that I paint from photographs, which I'm going to stop pretty soon, you know, I know what I'm going to make a painting about because I've dealt with the photograph, changed its space, organized the scale, built the stretcher. It takes weeks to figure out the sizes.
But would you say that there's been a big development within the way you think about painting?
I think a crown just came out of my mouth. I've been eating peanuts. This is very bad. What?
Sorry?
Never mind.
Excuse me?
Never mind. I've just had a dental event.
Oh. I thought you said something.
It's bad.
I was just saying,
I'm going to stop smiling.
If there was a, if you could sort of like point towards like certain shifts within your practice over the last decades where you would really say, oh, there's a change that has occurred and how that is maybe manifest also here in the exhibition through particular paintings.
Well, the most fun I had
styles in, present there.
You know, environment really does affect how one works. And I didn't want to think that was true because I'm a strong personality and I have for all my confusion, very clear thoughts about what I'm doing and what I want to do. But I got out to California after painting my good shows in New York that were landscape paintings in upstate, you know, around Rhinebeck. There's one painting from the 80s of the apple orchard. And I wanted the space and the light and the experience of making a response to what I was seeing. So when I was at Harvard, my work didn't get strong until I started working in Ipswich, till I spent some summers in Ipswich and got to paint this incredible tidal estuary. And the paintings were very long. And my joke was, boy, you could really get old and stand in the same place because the tide moves out 3 hours. In 3 days, you've got a different landscape. I don't have to move. I can just stay here. And that painting in the show, the pink one, that was painted on a little path on the way in Ipswich, looking at the, in the evening, looking at the light. And that was a very beautiful experience, except for the mosquitoes, of course. And I love doing it. I like to have adventures when I'm painting. Since my whole life is painting, I really like to put myself in a place where I'm interested in being. Also, I like to be outside. But when I was in Ipswich, I realized that New England really had nothing to do with me at all. I've told this story many times. I was involved in Ipswich lace. I was more confident about my intellectual life. I've been teaching at Harvard for a lot of years. I organized really interesting syllabuses, and my whole intellectual life sort of centered around the kind of classes that I developed. But I read, what was it? It's a book about a hermaphrodite, Middlesex. And I'm in Ipswich painting lace, 17-foot works on paper of Ipswich lace. I remembered that my grandmother, I guess everything's narrative, Jens, you're just stuck with it. My grandmother, my Polish grandmother crocheted, and I came to Detroit, didn't tell anyone I was here, stayed at a hotel, and went around seeing if there was anything that I could do in Detroit. And it took a long time to figure it out. The photographs I made of the house that I grew up in were painted were made in 89 or 90. I never thought I'd paint from a photograph. And I took photographs, I came back, and I knew I really wanted to do something about Detroit. Because I could finally face the fact that my dad was a carpenter, my mother came from a family that had been fancier. At Harvard, people would say, oh, Professor Mitchnick, and where were you educated? And I'd say, ever hear of Motown? I'd gotten over needing to be a snob. So I started painting. I had a sabbatical, and I went from these Ipswich landscapes it took a very long time, I won't tell the story, to painting these structured paintings of these buildings, because finally I could do it, and it interested me to be that clear. So the whole thing is a narrative, but when I'm painting, the narrative ends, and it's just me, a structure, my hand, the palette. And, you know, the very first house painting was that little one. It's Zeb's favorite. And it took a while to find the scale. One thing is, when I finally get it, I trust myself to know that I'm right. Could I tell you how that happens? I can't. I mean, that's the problem of being an intuitive romantic painter. You work until you get it. The work is in the painting. If you're a conceptual or classical painter, or artist, all the excitement is in the figuring out what you're going to do, and the work is in the execution. And I admire that work, but I can't change. I tried. I worked with plywood for 6 months once.
Have you ever tried working with other media? Photography, sculpture, thinking,
I'm dying. No, Zeb knows this. I was dying to make three structural pieces. My whole Detroit project also includes plans on the floor of the house that I grew up in, this beautiful wall. It's all connected to my studio life. We worked for weeks, Zeb and I and his assistants, to figure out this piece that would stand alone, be this incredible wall in my studio on 14th Street in Detroit, that was going to be 10 feet long, 10 feet high, I was going to make a piece about the corner in the house I grew up in. It was narrative, but the piece would have been strong about this doorway, these doorways that I could kind of close. And when I was a little kid, I'd be inside of them and pretend I was in a rocket ship getting out of there. I have all sorts of things I'd like to do, but the painting always takes up all my time. But I think I'll get around to it. I'm dying to do some other kinds of things. I teach my students. Lots of my students became conceptual artists, became conceptual painters. I don't teach out of my studio practice. I help. I'm very good at helping young artists figure out what they need, but it looks pretty crappy for the first year or two.
What would you consider the meaning of the term self-reflection within your practice?
100%. You know, I just sit there and look.
How does it articulate itself? Like, by reviewing the canvas over and over again and sort of like figuring out how to move on? Or is it sort of like something where that's maybe sort of more about the practice itself or the particular series of works that you work on?
Well, I was criticized in the New York Times for being ambivalent about color, using color, and not knowing anything about it, and it upset me. So I get to California, and I made the table paintings because I decided to get rid of all the flourishes and all the color that I just used absolutely randomly, sometimes very well, but I didn't have thoughts about the color. And the table paintings, like, it's always learning something. I've never stopped learning things. I would admit I'm a slow learner. So the table paintings just took away the flourishes and the color. I worked on them for a couple of years. I actually got a Guggenheim. I was quite surprised. And every painting will lead to another problem, so a lot of it is problem solving. The self-reflection that has to do with my own narrative comes after the paintings. The painting, and it's so happy to calm my overly busy mind that you are observing at this moment, and just look and sit there and know somehow when to make a mark or make a move. I use a lot of brushes. I have an enormous palette because I'm always trying to find the inevitable color, actually. And that sort of works out where you make the roof pink instead of green and the painting looks wrong, you find the green again. I can tell when if you change it, it becomes something else. It's my only criteria. Do you know the artist Charles Gaines?
Of course, yeah.
Well, he was a colleague of mine at CalArts. He's a guy who reads Derrida for fun. I tried to read Derrida. And, you know, Foucault's easy, but Thai's a breeze. Derrida is very difficult to decipher. So I get through about half of it. And I asked Charles, I said, how do you read this stuff? I know I'm not stupid, but I can't understand it. And I've studied linguistics a little bit, and I like to read Husserl, and I've read lots of philosophers. Kant's pretty good. He said, well, I had to read it 16 times before I really grasped it thoroughly. And I just thought, I'm not going to read this 16 times. I'm going to look out the window and paint a bloody tree.
Yeah, the more you talk and the more I look at your work and the longer I've gotten to know you, it just totally blows my mind that you were at CalArts at the same time as those people. Because I couldn't really imagine any artistic sort of endeavors to be more polar opposites.
Exactly.
You and Charles, Michael Escher, you and Charles Gaines, a man who like figures out his works based on mathematical equations. It's like that total opposite.
We
How
hung
did this
out.
All work?
Oh, it was really fun after I stopped being terrified. Catherine Lord put me and Michael Escher in an office together. We were in an office together for 10 years. It was a small office. I have a loud voice. Michael Escher had a life, had a laugh like a loon. It was loud and crazy. People would hear us laughing in there, and kids would say, what do you guys do in that office? Like, we told each other jokes. So
you must have been the only person who'd ever heard Michael Escher laugh, because famous for not having any sense of humor.
Oh, he has a tremendous sense of humor. He just pretended he didn't. You know, so one thing I realized about, I knew radical feminists who had baby showers I wouldn't have a baby shower, a wedding shower. I wouldn't have a wedding. I'd use the money to go to Florence, for Christ's sake. All these people, their politics, often the politics were their jobs. The biggest Marxist I knew, Michael, for one, had millions of dollars. He had a paper suitcase, slept in a mattress on the floor, kept film in his refrigerator, ate when the people came by with some trays of something out his window, wore the same pair of jeans for 30 years, drove a VW, but he sat on millions of dollars. I'd never had that kind of money. I think when people can afford to only live in their minds and work, some of those people are very safe, actually. But I was not safe. I think part of the reason I started to paint when I was a kid was to make my house pretty. I started out painting canisters and things all around. Wilbert came around and said, if you're serious about painting, you might consider canvases. But socially, people are the same. They're the same in Africa and in Australia. They eat, they have sex, they like children. So lots of our fun was more about life itself. But I could fight too. What I did, I don't know how it worked out. All I know is they respected me because I got my students to work. I got my students to think, and some of them became serious artists. And I was always a little insecure there. The bookstore was like my lending library. I think when painters who weren't as serious about painting as I was got a job at CalArts, after a few months they stopped being painters. The painters would begin to make work about the plumbing. They'd start doing work about geology. People stopped painting at CalArts. So Michael, who knew me from a semester that I taught there for a semester when I needed to get away. You know, there's an old girls' network as well as an old boys' network. I was having trouble with my boyfriend. I asked Elizabeth Murray, what's that school you guys go to in California? Could you get me a gig there for a semester? I've got to get out of here. So I get invited to teach at CalArts. Thank you, Elizabeth Murray. There was John Baldessari. Did I know who John Baldessari was? No, I was teaching at Bard College and painting trees. So we'd be in a critique. John would say, you know, your ideas are interesting. I'm glad that he's talking to a student, that you're beginning to think about the political discourse, but this is just a painting. So I'd look at this tall, wookie guy and say, what do you mean just a painting? Do you know how hard it is to make a painting? This is a serious painting. This kid's really working. It's visual. It isn't in language. And he'd say, well, Nancy, but you know, there is a discourse. And I'd say, yeah, but it's a hard painting. I don't get you. Shut up. Well, he fell in love with me because I was the only person brave enough to stand up to the guy. And we had fun for 25 years. Every time I went anywhere, there was John Baldessari. When I knew who he was, the next time I got a gig at CalArts, I didn't yell at him. I was just lucky and brave, I think, is what it was. And so thoroughly committed to painting. I think when, I didn't know this for years, Catherine didn't tell me. Michael Asher recommended me to teach painting because here are these poor idiotic children. Many of them, you know, CalArts lived on its tuition. Many of them kids who could pay the tuition and couldn't cut their SATs, for instance. And they figured while people wanted to learn to paint at CalArts, why not have somebody who wasn't gonna start teaching plumbing or geology or problems about communism? I actually lived in a communist family. We studied, I mean my husband's family, we studied Marx. We had to work with Engels once a week. We had Morris Bros teaching us Hegel on Wednesdays. Was I interested in Marxism? That family was a nightmare of selfish, you know, it was all guys and it would be Kenny's woman, cook 17 pies, the gang is coming for a discussion. I was done with communism. I didn't have a feminist language, but I was done making pies for these guys who called me Kenny's woman. Kenny wanted me to live on a boat in the Clinton River in the winter with our daughter. They were stealing engines from, you know, building sites to put his boat together. I wanted to go to school. We broke up. You know, it's just a story. It goes on and on. It's so lucky for me that I actually could paint. And it, I couldn't draw. No. My drawings came off the page. They didn't look like what I was trying to draw. My daughter says that Michael Lukes tells his story a different way, but he saw my drawings and he said, "You're not a draftsman, you're a painter. These are the drawings of a painter. Learn to paint, learn to draw while you're learning to paint." He brought me over some canvases. My first paintings were over weird electrified Indian heads and frogs that were slightly gessoed over that Michael Lukes gave me. There were years when I wondered, if he'd given me a guitar, would I be a singer who played the guitar? I don't know. For years, Ellen Phelan and I said, "Do you think we're really artists? We're living in New York, we're selling work." We'd say, "I don't know, maybe we are." 20 years later, "I think we are artists by now. I mean, the identity. I walked in here the other day and said, shit, it looks like real art. Fuck me." I mean, it was fun.
Surprise, surprise.
Finally, it's interesting to do. It's how I've lived my life.
Finally institutionalized, huh?
I'm institutionalized. I've deserved to be institutionalized for a long time. But it's been such a great opportunity, and it's been... You know, sometimes my studio looks like a group show. So what I've learned over the years dealing with art professionals who get very nervous is I've learned to build bodies of work, and I ask the kids who label. The paintings in front of Alicia's office are a series of paintings of women whose work I liked from Wonder Women. I painted Aretha Franklin, I painted Adrienne Rich, I painted great writers, I painted my mother, I painted Catherine Lord. I should start doing that again. Nobody bought George Eliot, she's homely. I was very sad about that. You know, so I've lived this somewhat difficult romantic life. I read a lot. The Pompeii came from my just loving this book I bought about Pompeii. For years I tried to paint these pretty leaf ones. They looked like greeting cards. I found this other amazing painting from the House of the Golden Necklace, I think. I'm gonna go there next year.
So maybe,
and that started all these paintings. It's just, it's luck and curiosity. My theory is trust
maybe
yourself.
We should see if there's questions in the audience.
Are you sick of me yet?
I'm not,
have
but I know.
Have I answered one of your questions?
I know that there's
ask
a rental
anything,
coming
but
up
be careful.
Here, and everybody's very eager to
my
hear you talk
too
more.
My front tooth fell out. If I'm going too far, just go like this and I'll shut up. Leave out? Oh, that's the hard part. I envy you writers. You can keep your drafts. To make the paintings as clear as my paintings look, ever notice the word pain is inside of painting? Who is a great poet who actually wrote about this? I have to cover up beautiful passages. I paint over tons of good stuff. I put it in, I take it out, I put it in, I take it out. That's the hardest thing. And it's cruel sometimes. So in my experience, the first hit can be anything. You're starting, you can try anything. Sometimes the first hit lasts 6 months. Then the second, you're pulling the things out that don't make sense. And I'm learning as I go along. Maybe it's more like creating the modern dance than if it's choreography. And then in the end, you're closing it up and getting it to hold together in a way that creates some kind of tension and is alive enough. I want them to be alive. I think my criteria is conceptual art, art that comes out of texts, like most of the Renaissance, the art that's absolutely political, the art that isn't visual, video, painting, drawing. There's good art, there's bad art, there's terrible videos, there's horrible paintings. It's very hard for people to figure out what's good art and bad art. It's a lifetime's work. But I've stopped being ashamed of painting. And I'm, you know, Mitch was a student of mine at Harvard. She's a brilliant architect. She's a great conceptual architect. She's showing at the Venice Biennale. She came to a painting class at the Carpenter Center. It's a Corbusier building. I went on and on to these kids about where they were sitting. They hadn't noticed they were in an interesting room.
Thank you very much.